Is technology going to change the way we do science? Is the communication technology going to change the way we are doing communication of science? And when I'm asking myself such questions, the first thing is I always want to go back and ask myself the basic question. So the basic question here is, why are we doing science? What are we trying to find, or what are we trying to understand? Basically, the universe, as you know, from the very big to the very small. And this is something which is absolutely universal. But to do that, we have to base our work on a chain of transmission. That is like building a wall. When you're building a wall, you're putting up bricks on top of each other. And of course, the one who finishes the wall is not the one who started it. And so you're building on somebody else's construction. And so this is really what is fundamental in science. You're working on work that has been done by others. Basically, as Newton liked to say, standing on the shoulders of giants. In fact, not necessarily giants, but certainly standing on the shoulder of other people who work before you, or who work at the same time as you do. And there was also 500 years before Newton, somebody who said that. John of Salisbury said exactly the same thing. When we perform science, we do it on top of what others have been doing. So basically, progress in science is based on communication. And nowadays, there is a revolution in communication. So is the revolution of communication going to impact on communication of science? And the answer is, of course, yes. We have been working with print works, with print communication, for several centuries. And we haven't changed a thing. We're still writing papers the way papers were written a long time ago. So there is no basic change in the way we are communicating. However, the real revolution in communication is the new tools that we're all using nowadays. And are we using these tools? Yes, a little bit. But when you think of it, the way we do it is we take papers, and instead of printing them, we put them on the web in printing form. So we don't change the way we do science. We don't change the way we communicate science. This is really the first observation that we can make. In fact, we have transposed an old system in new tools, but with the same system. And so, at this point, it is time to go from the 17th century, and we're still writing in the same way, to nowadays, with the new tools. And we should, of course, use what is existing, but we should also think of how we could possibly invent tools like Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn, or Google Plus, whatever. We should use tools like those to transmit information of science. And it is maybe not necessary to write our scientific papers the way we have done it for three centuries. We could probably make use of the tools to write it differently, communicate differently, shorten the ideas, shorten what we want to say. It's like making a conference in 18 minutes maximum. So exactly the same concept. Now, how do we communicate? We communicate orally in academies, meetings, and we communicate in written form through papers, books, chapters. But there has always been a scholarly cycle which looks like this. There is a scientist up there doing the experiments, and then he sits down, he or she sits down, and writes what will be a paper, which we call manuscript. And then this manuscript is being read by somebody else who is also a scientist and who is trying to find out whether it's okay or not okay, and there may be several turns. And when the paper is ready, it's being published, and when it's published, it's being read by another scientist. So all these people, all these blunt people here are all scientists. And they write the papers, they review the papers, they read the papers, and why the hell would they have to pay for all this? So there are intermediaries who are really sort of a problem. They are not a problem as long as they're practicing really fair fees. But when the price is going up, then it's no longer fair. So how can we, in fact, publish material without having to pay enormous amounts of money either to publish or to read? And this is the big challenge now with what we call open access to scientific publications. And so the classic model here is, okay, maybe you can't see very well yellow and green, but the yellow arrows are where the money flows, and the green arrows are where the scientific material flows. And so the public funds are funding the researcher. He becomes an author when he finishes his experiments, and he publishes. And then it's being reviewed by the reviewer, it comes back to the publisher, and the publisher provides the material to the reader, and the reader pays to read. That's the old classical system. But of course, it has evolved a little bit. And now we are going to a new situation where the public funds go to the researcher becomes an author, he sends his paper to a publisher, the publisher takes care of organizing the reviewing, and then presents the material to the reader, even online. And with this system, the author pays. It's what we call the open access, open access. It's fine, it's fair, it's normal, as long as the publisher doesn't want to make the same amount of money from this system as he did with the previous one. So it means that for the author, it is going to cost an arm and a leg and even more. So the system is certainly not the best one. So we're looking for a fair, what we call gold open access model, where the funds, public funds, are being given to the scientist for his research and to the publisher for the publication. Unfortunately, the arrow on the right is going to increase in terms of amounts, and nobody will be able to pay for this service. So the green open access route has been invented, where you have a mix of both systems, and the researcher, in fact, as an author, is publishing with a publisher who still publishes a review with a lot of value-added material, and the reader may still want to buy this review, but he can also, without paying for it, find it directly on the web. And the little dotted arrow shows that. The author puts his material up for consultation by the reader. Of course, the publisher finds that this is going to take him to bankrupt. But in fact, not, because he is adding value, and this value added can be valorized through the fact that the reader will still pay for having the review. But of course, this little arrow, this little yellow arrow here, will be less money than the publisher wants. So we're still at war with the publishers with this consideration. So The dream system is simply that the public funds fund research, the researcher puts his results openly in communication, everybody can read it, there's no publisher, and the whole system works by itself. The only problem is how do we have a good, serious, and professional review or organized peer review organized in the system. And so the difficulty is there, and we're still working on it. But of course, we are going to a new paradigm where the researcher does exactly that. He puts his material openly on the web for the reader, and the reader does the open reviewing, which is a new concept, where when you have published your material, people can look at it, make comments, put stars, 1, 2, 3, 4 stars, and in fact come back with a discussion and review, peer review or public review, your material after it's been published. So this is really what is in our view, but it needs a lot of precautions. Nevertheless, nowadays we can see that there is a new birth of a publication system where, in fact, we have publicly funded research, which is available for the public for free, and new knowledge is immediately available, which is a great speed, and the knowledge which is shared by everybody is progressing without barriers. This is an ideal system, and we should work on it. If we work on it, we should develop the tools for it. There are already many things that are in the pipe. First of all, the open data system, which has been approved by the Obama administration less than a week ago, and which is in a prototype with Horizon 2020 of the European Commission for the next framework program for research. Open data is a system where you put up your data, your raw data, available for everybody to look at, everybody to verify, everybody to use and to reuse. It's a completely new way of sharing scientific material, and it's a very difficult system to put up, of course, because you don't want to be to be stolen from your material, but you want it to be used by others so that the wall can be built. Interactivity means that you can interact with other people, and then your science is evolving in interactivity. Open reviewing, I just mentioned what it meant. Liquid publication is the fact that you can publish a paper and then come back to it and change it and say, I've done another experiment and it shows this and that. And so you have a basic paper, and you may have layers of different versions behind it, with dates, of course, with an identifier as a digital object, and then you can make all these digital objects one behind the other, and you can go and look through the whole series, which is also a very interesting way in sharing science. Then you have a transparency index, because you have to be completely transparent and your data can be demonstrated to be true. And then the reproducibility initiative is a big new initiative based on the fact that your material should be reproducible and your data should be reproducible. So in as a whole, we are really in the field of a new birth of science with a new and innovative approach, which is based on emerging technologies, evolving technologies that need improvement even now, but they are fully mastered by the young generation, which is of course a very important point. They permit immediate exchange of material, and they create a living and evolving scholarly communication, and no longer working on a fixed text that remains like it is forever. So in fact, this text can be changed, and you don't have to rewrite the whole thing. You may identify with an identifier, your methods, your references, and all this can remain a fixed frame to which you can go with a link from your paper, and your paper actually is no paper anymore, it's a text, or it's a film, or it's a video, or it's an interactive discussion, whatever material, and it can be exchanged very easily and refer to the basics, which should be very strictly controlled as a scientific matter. So the whole way that we are, in fact, not so much doing the experiments, but writing our data, writing down the data, and then communicating the data must be completely changed from the old classical way of transmitting science slowly. So this is what I was wanting to tell you this afternoon. Thank you.